I always maintained that our history was a history filled of sadness, a lot of embarrassment. But until we can come to face the reality of our past, we will never be able to sit together and build a future. There would always be a situation of distrust, a situation of divided energies. When I came back home, and many of us felt that we want to be part and parcel of the process. We want to gear our energies and our resources firstly towards making sure that SWAPO wins and that Namibia becomes an independent country. After independence, we hope that we can use the same energies and our resources for the reconstruction of our country, rather than always walking in the shadows of the past.
Well, I had a knife in the back, I'm afraid. That didn't come an easy way, but I presume when a man goes to war, when he goes to the battlefield, he does not anticipate commemoration or celebration. But at last, you see, I'm celebrating this independence of ours, which is a great achievement to me.
So that a lot of us have come back after a separation of years from our families and friends. A great many hadn't come back. Some who died for the cause of liberation, whose families would never know where their graves may be.
It is very clear that that we were engaged in the struggle for the liberation of our country and a struggle for the human rights and human dignity. Okay, now that we have achieved the independence of our country and we have a new government by the people, for the people, with the people, we will continue to educate our people in a human rights. You see, we have a constitution which I could say it said that it's the best one in the whole Africa, and probably it might be the best one in the whole world. So we'll try to educate our people to know their rights and their responsibility for the society.
Myself, I'm very happy to be back in my country where I'm born. Now, since I'm here, I'm standing on the camp where it was the camp of the South Africans, where they say that Namibian people, they won't come here in this country. Now, today, I'm here on the camp where it was prohibited the black people to be even moving.
Our nation suffered during the German colonial regime, and then during the South African government, and during the war, which really destroyed our nation and put it in pieces. People were affected psychologically and physically. There are many people who are still crying. There is a lot of wounds. So we want to concentrate on such a program, a national healing program, which covering all the people and their problems. But we are still at the beginning.
Yeah, we did. This place, it used to be an army camp, which was formerly called Battalion 61. And now we have turned it to a project which is called King Kauruma Resettlement Project. And this project is to resettle the retainees as well as the homeless people. We intend to resettle 2,000 people.
Are you yourself a retainee?
Yes, I'm a retainee.
Where were you in exile and for how long?
I've been also in several places. In Angola, Zambia, as well as in Tanzania. And I have did my study in Jamaica for 4 years.
How do you feel coming back to Namibia?
I feel good. Yes, I feel good. For somebody being away from home so for a long time, once you come back, I think you feel good. Yeah, well, the task is very difficult. As you have seen, the whole place is smashed off and every building was destroyed. So we are trying to rebuild it. We intend to make some factory on tailoring, and we also doing agriculture, and we also intend to put up various activities to create work, job opportunities. The work was supposed to start in February, but due to the scarcity of water, we have drilled 3 boreholes, but all of them, they are dried. We have made the requisition to the government to assist on us on this matter. I think they will come and bore and drill 1 borehole to 350 or 320 meters deep to see whether we can get water. Without water, we cannot do anything.
Priaris, you know, stands for repatriation, resettlement, and reconstruction. It's a program established by the member churches of the Council of Churches to facilitate the return of the Namibian exiles as part of a peace process, as you know, the Resolution 435. So we have had more than 100 food distribution points all over the country to supply food to the 44,000 Namibian exiles who are now, you know, inside the country. It's a difficult program, but somehow I believe we have managed up to this stage.
They are from Kenya. The father is a Namibian, but he got married to a Kenyan. I don't know how long he has been in exile, but he got married to a Kenyan and they came back with the repatriation process. So they are a family of 14 who's staying in the caravan, the father, the children and grandchildren. I think accommodation is the common problem, that's the serious problem, and then unemployment. In the past we found out that unemployment was just amongst the sort of unqualified people. But nowadays, with the return of the retainees, you find out that even the qualified people are unemployed too.
Is there anybody here amongst you that is employed, that is a breadwinner?
No. He was working on one of the restaurants in town and I stopped working last month. The owner suckers from the work and he sold the restaurant.
The owner of the work is the one who decided, I don't know what happened, she decided to go back to Japan. And later on now, they closed the hotel. So we were told just to be staying without going to work.
Have you tried to get another job somewhere?
Yeah, I'm trying, but I haven't got yet.
There's no really statistics at the moment. But as I understand, I think it's more than 50% of the population is unemployed.
Yeah. Well, I can't be disappointed, but on the other hand, I just see all Namibia is quite difficult, you know.
What is the main difficulty that you're finding?
Because nobody can exist here without money. You can't even stay here with, let's say, if take a case, if you've got 50 rand, that money is useless once you go to the shop, you see.
Like, for instance, to take this family, the only thing that we really tried to do to them was to give some financial assistance. And our financial assistance is also limited. It's only 50 rand per adult. That's for 3 months, and 25 rand per child. And that's not really enough. As she was saying, to go to a shop with a 50 rand is like just going and buy sweets. So it's not really enough for to maintain the whole family. Because most of the owner of the houses want the retainees to pay for their accommodation. And they're asking us from 100 rand upwards. So with the 50 rand, they can't do anything really.
Actually, I like Namibia very much. The only difficulties we have is about the housing.
At the moment, I can say it's difficult and I actually don't know what is going to happen in future. But if there is nobody in our family who is working, then life is going to be difficult. And also in future, I don't think it's going to be okay.
At the same time, we've been then registering the skills of retainees in order to determine where they could get jobs. But in those cases that we have tried, we have also sensed that there was a discrimination in the private sector, especially against the retainees. But within our own framework, realizing or after taking down the skills of the retainees here and there, we try to develop some project, some kind of self-help project.
Yes, I'm happy, but I got a problem of jobs and accommodation. And my family are there, they are not there. My father is dead because of war. Only my mother is here.
And how do you see the future for yourself and your family?
I don't know, because even now I don't have a job. I'm just trying to do this garden.
What kind of job would you like?
I have a certificate for labor administration.
So the idea is to get them started. They'll get a certain allowance, say, for the first 6 months, but after which they will hope to take over. In other words, this will be their cooperative. It will be their own thing. But it's a small scale. It's a small scale, whatever the churches can do. It's a small scale. There's a much larger problem.
Because here in Atumbiwe, we don't have job opportunities, and then we sit and talk to each other, and then we said, let us establish something where we can earn money, and so we start with this project. But after the retainees came to Chimbingwe, then we decided to make the group bigger, and now we have 43 women from outside and also from the retainees. And well, that is our aim. to bring these two groups together so that there can be more better understanding. And we really succeeded with this. The local women really like to come and join with this, the retainee women. And so we are learning from each other, you know, we are coming from different cultures, but I think here you will not even observe that we are coming from different cultures. That work relationship is very good.
Of course, some retainees, and a substantial number of them, have had training in fields that the blacks in this country have not been trained for. You know, the system of apartheid that existed here and that exists in South Africa, and the education system which was earmarked for blacks, such that it had deprived blacks chances to enter into some fields. The retainees will or have skills in areas in which many people in this country, you know, were not trained. The problem lies with the large number of retainees, the young men and women who were in the armed forces. Now that's a difficult area because of their involvement in the struggle. There will be no time or no opportunity for them to get particular training in many other fields except the military and those related, you know, to military matters. And that is the substantial number of people we are talking about.
How long were you in the war? How many years?
Me? For 11 years.
For 11 years?
Yes.
Yeah. How does it feel to be back in Namibia?
So I'm feeling okay.
Did you win the war?
Yes, we win the war, of course. Yes, of course, we are the winner. We are independent. As you've seen, we are in our country.
What now? What for the future?
For the future. Of course, we are ready to defend the country.
Have you seen your family?
Not yet.
Yeah. You're looking forward to seeing your family?
Yes, of course.
Of course, some could be then taken up in the new army or the police or the many other departments coming forward.
This is the Namibian National Army soldier from Grootfontein. Yes, this base was a base of South Africa military, but now it is come to a Namibian National Army base.
But the size of the army, as we hear now from the defense minister, will not be such that everyone can be, you know, incorporated. And I don't think it's the wish that everyone, you know, go into the army. So this is where the problem lies. So these people will then join, like you said, a huge number of people, you know, already, you know, unemployed. So besides that, we have had special groups, such as the disabled persons, retainees who have been maimed by war. And we have had preparations for special centers in which they will be, because they will need special care, medical attention, and so on. There we offer some kind of a special assistance to these people, not encouraging them to stay there, but those that need help. You know, some needed the artificial leg replaced and this kind of things, we try to help them. But then we have drawn up programs now to rebuild these centers into well-equipped centers that can serve not only these people, but the community, so that they can have a means to do something develop some skills, maybe made some of the artificial limbs themselves there and these kind of things. And we try to help them where they can.
How do you feel now that independence has happened?
Now, that is what you saw. We are happy.
Are you happy?
Yes.
What will happen for the future? Will you stay here? Or are you going back to your family?
Yeah, I'm going to my family.
Will you be able to get a job?
I think that I'm going to get a job, but now I don't have. Yeah.
What kind of job are you looking for?
I don't know.
I think the solution to everything is just to get some jobs for the people. At the moment, really, everybody is trying to do something. Even if the government start to do something, I don't think it will be enough, really. It's not just for the retainees. Maybe one should not see the retainees in isolation from the people who used to stay in the country.
There are many needy people in this country also. When the retainees came, the children were far healthier than most of the children here. And you could see, you know, they were well taken care of. But it has also been difficult for me, for example, we being the arm of the council, which has to deal with retainees. In some cases, I've had people coming here who are not retainees because they see clothes being given out or food being given out or some money, basic assistance be given out to retainees. We have come and asked. And it has been difficult to turn someone away because they are not a retainee.
Ek werk van al die werk wat ek ken. Hy se pou, aan swys, aan pynde. Ek is alles.
En hoeveel betaal hulle vir jou?
Ek kry van R50 per maand. Laat hierdie 2 maand van al twee, ek het nie gekry nie. As ek het homself gepraat, het het my kos gegee.
Hoeveel kos?
Hy het my so 1 sakje, R50 sakje gegee. Maar daai kos, maar hy koop nie die kos van die varkens nie, maar ek daai randsoes by my randsoes af. Ek gee die nog varkens kos. Ek kan nou nie sê aan hoe gaan nie, maar ek bly net sommer so die man wat hulle van Namibia se land wat hulle ken was. Ek net so leef.
Ja, ons kreeg nou van R40 dat ons kreeg.
R40
per maand? Voor de maand.
En
wat werkt er niet? En daar worden we 10 bekers en 1 veet en 1 chirurgies en 1 thee en kabelijk tabak. Het is al klaar.
I think the biggest problem at the moment is unemployment. And then those people who are employed are not paid decent salaries. So they also are very poor, like the unemployed. And we have here the extended family life. So sometimes only one breadwinner in a family of really 3 nuclear families. I think the only way that one can really help our people, you should also think how to empower your people economically. They will never be able to compete on that level with the business people because they are very powerful in this country. So to build our people slowly but surely in production cooperative so that they themselves can control their own production process and the profit. And that will also ensure that some of the factories will stay in the hands of Namibians and not go to the hands of foreigners, you know. People invest and they take the money out of the country. But when you have cooperatives, you also need a good backup system for cooperatives. Skilled people can slowly but surely carry over the skills to the cooperatives. Economic independence is one of the ideals that we are fighting for now. And that's, I think, the biggest battle ahead. Some scholars actually co-op for people to get their own houses, but it broadened its aims now so that it became a community development program where people are not only worried anymore about the houses, they're also worried about it, but they also want a better income. Some of them are starting small businesses and others want to improve their skills. So people are busy with a multi-issue development program. So the house was the issue around which we mobilized people. But then people also start realizing the most important thing is the income.
What are the major monthly expenses for her family?
She said the piece of land when they're staying here. She's just paying this plot with all her money.
How much is she paying for?
They pay services, although they are not tapped yet. They pay about 110 per month. But the plot's down payment over 5 years is 38 rand.
Where do they get the water from?
Waar krijg je de water vandaan?
Here is the oldest.
Yeah, she's getting it from another Samstan member.
Is there a tap nearby?
Yeah, it's about 4 plots from here.
How many taps in this area?
Each plot is supposed to have a water pipe and a connection, but the connection is quite expensive. It costs about 200 rand just to connect it. Now, if they do not have money to pay that connection, they usually help each other with the water.
Mm. Hij weet niet, maar hij weet niet, maar taxi is een stukje. Hij rijdt een taxi.
Her husband is unemployed at the moment. He's a taxi driver, but the taxi is not in good condition, so he cannot drive it. Her sister is and her uncle is helping her, and I think she's mentioning the most important thing for her is a home.
Does she feel more hopeful about the future now that independence has happened? Has it changed her life at all? Does she feel it significant?
Voel je nou na onafhankelijkheid dingen zijn nog verander en ook jouw leven zal een beetje verander?
Mijn leven is altijd leuk achter toe. Hij voelt niet lekker.
Nou, na die onafhankelijkheid voel je niet deze veranderingen die. She says she's not experiencing it. Her life is just going backwards. Yeah, the ordinary people cannot see really the change yet because it's also too soon to see any changes. And it's so many wrongs that have to be rectified before person can see changes. So those people who really experience the changes are those people who always had the power, the economic power, because now more markets open up for them, sanctions are cancelled, and they have now the opportunity to compete in sports for the world. So the international world is opening up to them, but not for the ordinary people. sort of ordinary people still sort of poverty and the problems that they have. And it's maybe only going to change if there's a real change in economic policy too.
How are things now that Namibia is an independent country?
I would say quite normal. Changes have been so far only superficial.
Are you happy with the situation here?
At the moment, yes.
You said that things are a lot different to what you or what many people expected. What did you expect?
I think they were expecting riots and, you know, and trouble and, you know, that they were going to lose their houses and this sort of thing, that the blacks might just take over there and all that sort of thing. And I mean, none of that's come about at all.
We know now that the government cannot do otherwise than to introduce this reconciliation program, because it's ensuring peace and it's ensuring that those with the technology stays in the country. But on the other hand, it feels that everything that we have struggled for cannot be achieved because we still have to bend our knee for peace sake. We hope that those people who have the economic power realize that the peace can only be ensured if everybody has a good, a decent life. Because as long as people are poor and unhappy, people will feel there's something wrong with a system. So you cannot only reconcile by keeping peace with those who have, but you also have to keep peace with those who don't have.
I myself have problems with the policy of national reconciliation, not in principle, because I think it's a very good policy indeed, and the only one that can manage to really balance things out in Namibia at the present stage. But I have felt in the past, and I have expressed this feeling, that reconciliation has meant more to the white community in Namibia. It seems that SWAPO, as the new government, is largely reconciled with the business community, which is well and good, and there's no problem with that. But while they have reached out the hand of friendship, it seems as though the white business community themselves have not responded in like manner. Particularly the whites in this country expected the worst of a SWAPO government. They really expected to see Marxists and communists, and instead they have someone who has been very conciliatory towards the business community here. But certainly SWAPO, unless they reach out similarly to the majority of the black community and start looking to their needs, are going to find themselves in problems at the next election.
You know, I'm just saying that, reconciliation should be for all. If this government wants to reconcile itself with the Boers and the ex-soldiers of 101, they must reconcile themselves with the detainees. And they have to discuss the whole detainee epic. And if people's heads have to roll, then they must roll, you know.
The feeling is that SWAPO, who was responsible for the detention of people and accusing them as, you know, as being spies, haven't really attempted to resolve the issue. A lot of parents whose children were victimized by SWAPO or whose children never came back were devoted SWAPO members and who didn't want to see it as causing SWAPO, who had, for all intents and purposes, a record of struggle over the years, to lose the elections and therefore, you know, revert the struggle back to 30 years ago. And it was in that vein that people, those who were SWAPO members, for example, like the parents and so on, put their pain and their personal emotions behind their back to ensure that SWAPO wins the elections. And I feel that it is a responsibility of SWAPO towards those of us who remained loyal SWAPO members, to the parents of those children who may have died in the detention camps, who haven't been back now, and even those who are back but who have been accused as being spies, to be told what has happened and to be assured that what has happened in the past will not be repeated in the future.
I mean, I knew Achab, and it was very difficult for me to like just suddenly turn my back on these stories of the young boy's detention. You know, I could see that he was a very, very smart young man. And I know he would get into trouble because he would never keep his mouth for anyone. Well, he hasn't come back, you know, and as far as I'm concerned, you know, it's very difficult for me to like digest that this whole free nation is now free when there are not people that are back. I got to know Achab about 3 years ago when he was the young student leader in Katatoro. I saw him at, you know, all the rallies. You know, it was the time of the boycott, the school boycott, about 3 years ago. And he was like one of the, you know, big student representatives and heroes of the day. And I mean, there were like so many different stories about what happened to Achab. So many allegations, you know, varied from him being refusing to do his military call-up or military training in Angola, to stories of him like last being seen with blood streaming down his nose and ears. But he definitely hasn't returned.
Since that time, I never hear nothing about him. The only thing is, the third detainee is now, the second detainee is in 89, and August is coming. And there was a one Ovample guy, Eliezer is his name, but he is from Rundu. He told us, the parents committee, especially for me, that he know Joseph. He and Joseph was in one in camp, I mean in the pit. And one day the guards has hit Joseph very and things to know what else happened there. And he said to the one of the guards, if he in life and he come back to Namibia, Namibia will know what's going on. And the next day, in the early mornings, about 4 o'clock in the morning, they take him out the boat and they take him away. And no one see him again since that day. The whole Namibia people know what Joseph was. There was people coming to me in the street. Hello, mother. Are you the mother of Joseph? Yes, I am. Oh, what a boy he is. He is so powerful. He know he is a real leader. That some people say that. The thing is, what Eliezer has tell is that when he come there, the security, they tell, they say he's a big spy. This is the thing. There was no one who can explain. So I think those who are here, the letters here in Namibia, they know what Joseph was. They used Joseph. Do you know how many things did they do with Joseph? They used my son like a tool. Give it, you know, they use him to do all the dirty work. If any one of them come to me and say, I'm sorry about what happened, we didn't mean that. Do you know, that it will make me a little bit better.
I also think if he has been held in against his own will, if he's been held in detention, I mean, he's one of many. And the issue hasn't been discussed. And the same men that were responsible for these detainees and the detention of these people and the violations of these people's rights are still there today in government.
This is no longer time to be on the defensive. This is a time to confront the issues, to be, you know, as I said, to tell people, the Namibian people have a right to know the truth. They are the ones who voted SWAPO into power, despite, you know, whatever happened in the past. And I think that is what SWAPO should do.
I mean, this is a detained society. It's a society where people were detained inside Namibia by SADF and South African elements, and a society that was detained by the liberator. Now that everyone's back, I mean, all these people that did the detaining are now in government, you know, and are quite happily in government. I mean, they're all well reconciled, all in flashy cars. But, you know, what I'm saying is that a leopard doesn't change its spots. And once you've committed these atrocities, and once you've abused human rights, you'll continue abusing human rights. And I mean, that's why we have to discuss this now and redeem ourselves of these security men that stained the struggle.
And compatriots, that is, we have now established a democratic society. Let us forge ahead as a single defense force entrusted with the common responsibility of consolidating our hard-won freedom and independence. Forget the past. Let us embrace one another with open hearts and arms, as brothers and sisters, as members of one family, as children of one father and one mother, and as a citizen of one country, Namibia. Thank you.